Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you can hear me. Peter, is my audio okay for you?
Yes, absolutely, Simon. I can hear you loud and clear.
Very good indeed. So good afternoon, everyone. Good evening, or whatever time of day it is where you are. A very, very warm welcome from me. For those who don't know me, my name is Simon Lind. I work for the same organization that Peter does, but I'm based in Cambridge, at our headquarters in Cambridge, and I have the most wonderful job when I'm allowed to do it, because I travel and visit countries around the world, working with schools and educators, helping them to improve the standards of teaching and learning within their schools and within their classrooms. And a big function of what I do is what I'm talking about today, which is trying to make our teachers a little more language aware. I work across the age groups, so in primary and in lower secondary, even at IGCSE and above, and I cover multiple subjects. But today we're going to concentrate on looking at how we think about and use language in the classroom and how we can plan for using that language. I'm very aware that when we are in school, our schools expect us to do sometimes quite detailed lesson planning. I'm not for one minute suggesting that we actually have to change what we actually write down, but I would like us to think very much about how we approach and build in this idea of language awareness. For those of you who are familiar with the terminology, we are also, and we will see them in the slides, thinking a little bit about what is often referred to as CLIL, content and language integrated learning. So it's this idea where we can use language not just in a language lesson, so for example learning English or Arabic or Indonesian or whatever language you like. It's all about thinking about what we do across the subjects. So I'm going to start just by asking us to think firstly, what language do you actually think in? So in other words, what is your home language? What language do you think in? So when you are forming your thoughts, what language do you think in? And as most of you, I'm absolutely certain, are bi or even trilingual, you speak multiple languages, do you think in those languages too? So I really want us just to start thinking. Many years ago, I learnt some other languages. I rather teasingly say, oh, I speak English. I speak Indian English, African English, Middle Eastern English, Indonesian English, Canadian English, American English, Australian English, but I think in English. I did actually learn at one stage how to speak a bit of French, a bit of German, a bit of Dutch, a bit of Italian, a bit of Spanish, but I don't necessarily think in them unless I'm actually in those countries and have been for some time. So think about what languages do you think in? Do you, when you're teaching in English, do you think in English? Or are you still having to translate into your home language, your mother tongue?
Simon, are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Can you see the chat box, or would you like me to tell you what they're saying?
I can't see the chat box. I'd rather not see it unless if you've got something that you can interrupt and just tell me, that would be perfect.
Just to say, I've seen about 25 different first languages, including English.
Absolutely.
Or thinking languages, let's say.
Thinking languages, that's exactly what I wanted. That's brilliant. So that is fantastic. That shows us that we're on the right track, that we think in our language. Because I also want us to think about what situations do you find yourself struggling for words, that you're thinking in one language, but you're not necessarily, you don't necessarily have the vocabulary, perhaps in English, your working language, whatever language it may be. So when do you actually struggle for words? I just want you to sort of think about that. And then, of course, what language do you dream in? Because that's always a killer. What language do you dream in? Now, I want us to think about this from our students' perspectives. And when we talk about this, we're talking about language competence. So I want you to think about when you perhaps come into school. We're not allowed to go to school, obviously, now. But say, for example, it's the beginning of the week. You come into school and you're having a chat to the students around there. And you ask them, oh, what did you do last night? Or did you have a good weekend? You're just making some lovely conversation. And the students respond really well. And they say, oh, yes, we went out. We watched a film. We did this. We went and we had a wonderful party. We met the family. And then a few minutes later, you're in the classroom. And your same students are sitting in front of you, and you start the lesson, and you ask them some questions, and they struggle. They can't respond. They can't necessarily read the text that you're doing. If it's a maths or a science lesson, they're really struggling. Do you find that? Just think about that very quickly. And if you want to use the chat box, just put a Y if that is sometimes a situation that you find yourself in. And then I want you to think about, well, is that because when you ask them a question, do you know if they actually don't know the answer? In other words, is it a content idea? Do they not know the answer? Or do they have the vocabulary to express themselves? They might know the answer, but they can't tell you because they haven't got the words, perhaps in English, because they're thinking in one language, but they don't operate in the other language. And this is what I want to talk about, this idea of being language aware. And here on this slide, I've mentioned the fact that it includes content and language integrated learning. And many people are really frightened by this idea of CLIL, that, oh, I can't do that because I don't have the language skills. It's not that. And we mustn't think about it like that. So let's think about when we teach in another language, that many of the schools that we work in, and almost entirely the ones that I become involved with, are what we call bilingual schools. That we're teaching probably in English. Most of our lessons are in English, some are not, but it's not necessarily the student's home language, nor is it necessarily the teacher's home language. But we recognize that English, in this case, is the world's probably the world's most important or widely used language. It's the language of the internet, for example. It's the language of commerce and business. It's the language of sport. Wherever you are, English is the language that we have to get hold of. And most people actually learn to speak English, not in order to go to an English-speaking country, but so that they can talk to people from other countries who are also learning English. So let me think about it. Are you perhaps an English teacher who's been asked, because you're competent in English, oh, please go and teach maths, go and teach science, go and teach history, go and teach geography, go and teach civic studies, whatever it is? Or are you perhaps a geographer or a mathematician, but you are teaching in English, you know the words, but you don't necessarily have the English equivalent? So this is the dilemma that we find ourselves in. Now, when we look at perhaps a Cambridge book, for example, here is a little one. This one is a primary science book. And in this one, this is what the children would see. Now, this is book two, so this is for young learners. And as you can see, we've recognized in this particular book, the approach that we take is to recognize that children are learning language as well as science. So we've got words to learn, and those are words like different, measure, mini beasts, record. So you've also got lots of visuals, you've got pictures. But if we look at the text down at the bottom of the pictures, it says, look at the pictures. Which animals and plants live in each environment? Now, most of our students will be able to readily answer that. They can see a crocodile, they can see a pink flamingo, they can see a fish. The answers only require really one word. Who can see the scorpion? There's a fascinating one there. There are two scorpions in there. And there's a lion. But if we look at the next question, it says, what differences can you see? Now, when we look at that, that You can't answer that in one word. You have to give a well-structured sentence, because it requires a little bit more than a single word answer. We have to, as teachers, be aware of this, and we have to plan for this eventuality. If we want our students to succeed in answering that second question, we have to help them. We can't just expect them to know the words. We have to help them manage that. A lot of teachers say, well, I can't do it. I don't have time. And what happens in many cases? What happens if I make a mistake? I don't want to look stupid. And it's not my job to teach language. There are all sorts of things. But for most of us, we don't have to go into it in that kind of detail, because I am not talking about formally teaching language skills. Let's think about how we used to learn languages. And for those of you who work in schools with parents who come along and say, well, if it was good enough for me, it's good enough for my children, they might have learnt language in a quite old-fashioned way, where you learn carefully structured grammar and core vocabulary, and then you practice it repeatedly. So you learn, this is the present tense, this is the past tense, this is the future tense. And you learn your grammar first, and you learn one type, but then it doesn't reflect everyday language. Because if you think about a simple sentence that you can say, well, yesterday I was sitting at home and it was pouring with rain, today I'm still at home, and tomorrow I'm most likely still to be at home. I've used three different tenses in one sentence. So you can think about, maybe that necessarily doesn't work. But if we think about the way that we try to approach language teaching within Cambridge, we want to use what we call a communicative approach. And this is where we think about communicating meaning and not worry about, are we getting it grammatically perfect? We need to think, let's communicate first. Can I be understood? Can I make myself understood? If it doesn't work, then we think about use of English or grammar to improve the communication. So the first thing is we think about it in a different way. Can I make myself understood? Can I communicate meaning? So if we think about that, we need to think about how we work together. So the communicative approach focuses on, let's communicate. We recognize that even in our home language, we never communicate absolutely perfectly all the time. We can't expect that to happen. And as it so happens, living in England, most of you who have learnt English as a second or third language actually speak far better English than many people in my own country, because we just don't care. If you've ever watched an interview with a footballer on television, you'll know exactly what I mean. When every other word has got like in it, it becomes quite difficult to understand at times, apart from our regional accents. So when we think about this, learners involved in real communication, having to communicate, it means that they will use innate strategies. In other words, the language strategies that you learn with your mother tongue will become involved in your second language learners. And as teachers, we need to give them an opportunity to actually use and develop these strategies, not just memorize something and repeat it without thinking about it. Professor Do Coyle, who some of you may very well know and have heard speak, as I have, has got what she calls a four C's model. And if we put content in the middle, we think about what is it that we actually want to learn. That's the content. How are we going to learn it? Well, the first thing is we have to communicate. That's how we're going to learn the content, by communication. Teacher to student, students to students, reading a textbook. We have to communicate. And that's where we use our languages to learn. And at the same time, we are learning to use languages. Then we must see, and I'm going to go to the other side, cognition. This is the other element, if you like, of education. It's the thinking skills. We have to give our students and ourselves an opportunity to think and to express our thoughts. Cognition, we can say it's intelligence, it's the mind, it's what we do, it's problem solving, it's how we approach it. But as I said right at the beginning, what language do you think in? So our thinking skills are very closely tied to our cognitive skills. And the one at the bottom is culture. Now, the people, what's culture got to do with it? Well, a lot of it depends on your cultural background and the way we can also think about the culture in our classrooms. Do we encourage our students to express their ideas, or are they so terrified of making a mistake they don't want to say anything because they won't get it right? What is that? And what about our own selves? So our personal cultures, is that what we want to do? Do we want to learn, or are we just not interested? So when we think about this, these have got to be in the back of our minds as we plan our lessons. So thinking about it, language is used to learn as well as to communicate. And it's the subject matter which determines the kind of language we need to learn. And therefore, when we start planning our lessons, we really have to take this into account. We really must think, what is the purpose of our lesson? What are we learning and how are we going to learn it? So at Cambridge, we're quite keen on this idea of active learning. Some of you may very well be aware of this, but we may also be very aware that much of our classrooms are fairly traditional. It's our culture, it's what we expect, it's the way that we operate. Where, as teachers, we talk most, like I'm doing now. I'm going to be talking to you for the next hour. I don't necessarily like it, but actually we're quite good at it. And for many of us, our status is determined by how well we talk. Classrooms are quiet. Students learn by memorizing. We mustn't make mistakes. It's not good enough. And the only form of assessment is writing. We have to do everything written because the school wants a record, and that's what parents demand. But we should start thinking about thinking and working a slightly different way, that we want our students to actually engage in conversation, but not just with us as a teacher, to each other, that we want them to actually communicate to each other. That's the biggest challenge. If you teach teenagers, you'll know all about that. There's no way that a teenager is going to talk to their friends in a different language and look stupid in front of the rest of their friends. We have to be aware of this, okay? Younger children, they are a little more open to it. But we want our students to be in an environment where they can learn from each other. And mistakes provide an opportunity to adapt and improve and learn from, not just, oh, right, I've got it wrong, that's the end, I'm giving up. We want to change it. There's lots of theories around this, and we talk about growth mindsets and how we learn from our mistakes. And we talk about resilience, where, you know, some children, the moment they make a mistake, they just go to pieces and they say, right, I'm giving up, I can't do this, etc. So we need to think about that. So I want to introduce you to some ideas of what we call language aware. Now, this is based on the work of Emeritus Professor Jim Cummings, who is actually, he's an Irishman living in Canada, and he's done his work. And when we talk about being language aware, this is what we talk about. And remember I said, when we talk to the children as we come into school, perhaps, or at a break time, and they do really well, they are using what we call basic interpersonal communication skills. Simpler way to think about it is your social language. It's conversational, it's social, it's everyday language. Jim Cummings calls it BICS, basic interpersonal communication skills. And fluency takes 2 or 3 years to achieve. On the right-hand side of the picture, you will see the iceberg analogy. Now, the iceberg, as we all know, icebergs have got most of their mass, if you like, hidden under the water. We see the tip of the iceberg. That's what BICS is all about. Our immediate and apparent idea of language is what we see, what we communicate in. It's the social language. Jim talks about CALP, cognitive academic language proficiency. In other words, this is the school subject. It's your school language. It's the language of classrooms. It's the language of different subjects. Each of those subjects has their own unique language. Even English has its own specific language that you have to use that won't necessarily be part of your basic interpersonal communication skills. CALP, or cognitive academic language, takes a little bit longer to develop. But if we are aware of this, we can help our students develop strategies to learn and grow their cognitive academic or their school language. So one of the ways that we can think about doing it is just by being aware of the environment of our classrooms, so and our schools, well, and even in society. Now, on this little matrix here, you'll see the cross in the middle, the four arrows. And on the left-hand side is what we call cognitively undemanding. It's fairly simple. We don't have to think too hard about that. So right on the very left-hand side, it's easy. It's not challenging. On the right-hand side, it's fairly academically challenging. It's cognitively demanding. It makes us think. So, for example, we're learning a new topic, we're learning a new subject. It's cognitively demanding. At the top of the page is what we call context embedded. Now, that means that we get additional clues from our surroundings in order to understand the language and the content. So, for example, a face-to-face. If you can see someone, you can read their facial expressions. You can tell whether they're happy, they're sad. Have you ever tried, and you should try this with your kids if you're at home, or try it with each other, or whenever you get the opportunity, but try saying something in a very angry tone of voice with a big smile on your face. It's kind of difficult. So if we look at context reduced, it's the opposite end. There are no clues to help us think about the language or the content. So, for example, if we go to the top left-hand corner, we talk about storytelling or social conversation. Oh, what did you do last weekend? It's not challenging to think about, and because it's face-to-face, it's nice and easy to chat about. But then we get into the classroom and we say, okay, open your textbook, now I want you to read this, and we haven't even thought about that. Suddenly it's cognitively challenging, there's very little social help and no nonverbal clues, and suddenly you're asking your students a question and they haven't a clue because we haven't prepared for it. The other two quadrants you can see, you know, if for example you're teaching mathematics and you are teaching about shapes or geometry and you actually give them things that they can touch, so a little solid triangles, spheres, balls, cubes, etc., that really helps. If you're doing science lessons, for example, and you take them into the lab and they can see the test tubes and they can see the Bunsen burners, that's much easier for them, although it may be a new situation. And in the other one, think about the difference between a face-to-face conversation and a telephone conversation where you can't see the person on the other end. So these are what we talk about and what I want us to think about. So the next time that you just ask them to open their books and start reading without giving them any preparation, you're immediately putting them in that bottom right-hand corner of cognitively demanding, context reduced. There are times when we have to do that, but we need to think about it. We need to plan for it. If that's what we want to do, let's plan how we're going to help our students succeed in that particular situation. And this is what I want us to think about. This is this idea of planning for language awareness. And I talk about content language, functional language, and language skills. So I'm going to show you a picture. And in this picture, I want you to think about, and again, if you want to use the chat box and Peter can look at it and see some answers, here is a picture. And I would like you to come up with some words and ideas where you could tell me to think about an English lesson. What words would you tell me to describe that picture? So often, as a teacher, especially when we get to secondary school in English lessons, we say, describe that picture or describe what's happening. So have a go. I'm just going to give you just 30 seconds. What words would you come up to describe that picture?
Hi, Simon. We've got the word energy, windmill, wind, nature, resources.
Now, nature, those are all very science words. What about some English descriptions? So if you were having to tell someone in an English lesson, what does that picture look like? We've got some lovely science words, but I want English words this time. So what do we come up with?
Fresh air, beautiful, weather, clouds.
Oh, wind, we've got clouds.
Air, green grass.
Oh, we've got some green grass. Lovely.
Bright and sunny, white, spring.
Excellent.
Triangle, fan.
Now, just between you and me, Peter, while we're here, would you call those lovely descriptive words for an English language lesson?
Many of them are nouns, aren't they? They're not really descriptive
words. They're not really descriptive words. So in other words, if we say to our students, describe something without giving them any help, it actually is not very easy to do. We really need to think about it. And so often I hear teachers say, describe something. How do you describe it? Where do you start? So I'm going to suggest that before we do anything, we need to take any picture, and almost every picture you can do this. Divide your picture, your photograph, into three. You'll have a background, which in this case is the sky and clouds. You'll have a foreground, which in this particular case is the green in front, the grass, the flowers. And then you will have a subject, which in this case are the windmills, the wind energy. So if you think about those, you've got very clear steps. Now I could say to you, tell me about the background, or tell me about the foreground, or tell me about the subject. And if I divide each of those then into three, talk about color. What colors can we see? Obviously we've got blue sky, we've got white clouds, but is white the only color of the clouds? And what about texture? Now, by texture, I mean, what does it, if we could touch it, what would it feel like? A typical example of texture might be fluffy white clouds, because it feels soft and fluffy. And what about patterns? Can we notice any particular patterns in there? Now, if we do this with our students, it suddenly becomes much easier for them to describe, because we've broken it down into manageable bits. We can say, can you tell me about the sky? Can you tell me about the foreground? So for example, when I did this, and I'll ask you to think about this now, what words could you come up with? And here again, Peter, we can just have a quick look at this. Now think about words to describe the background. Think about color, texture. So that, for example, I might say, look at that cloud up in the top there. To me, that's a wispy white cloud. It looks like torn lace draped across the corner of the picture.
We've got blue sky with fluffy clouds, beautiful sky, fresh atmosphere, fluffy white cloud with a silver lining, cotton soft clouds like cotton candy.
Now, suddenly, it's getting so much better, because our learning and our language is more directed. That's fantastic. That's so that we can see that. So, for example, I thought about this and I said, okay, background, deep blue sky. I'm using color and texture. Thin, wispy clouds bullied into the corner. I'm putting a little bit of context in that. What about the other ones? Dark, glowering clouds ganging up on the horizon. Those are what might term background descriptions. And I've tried to build in a lot of additional things, but that's background. Foreground, flowers like golden teardrops twinkling in the sun. Tall, elegant turbines marching proudly across the verdant green landscape. To me, they almost look like soldiers. They're so beautiful and proud and standing there. But this is English description. I'm not talking about science. So that now we can see that if we break our picture down into three sections, it's much easier to look at. So for example, let's have a look at this book here. Now in this story, which is called The Seekers, and this I think comes from book 6 or 7, somewhere up there, and we can see the picture. Now here, again, we can quite clearly see a background, a foreground, and subjects. And the very first thing that happens is talk about it. Who are the children in the picture? Why do you think they're called the seekers? What are they looking for? So a really good thing is to approach looking at the picture and say, what's in the background? Tell me about that castle, that picture. What color is the sky? What color is the castle? Why do you think it's that gray color? What does that tell you about how it might feel to be there? And then we come down to the foreground and we can see the path. It's leading away from the castle. What are the children doing? What do they look like? How are they dressed? So where we think about that, we can actually put that into practice. We can help our students, but we must do one more thing. We need to look at that picture, and if we want our students to describe it well, they now know to break it to foreground, background, and subject, but we need to help them with the words that they can use. Don't expect them just to know the words. We need to give them help for those words. Once we can do that, then as they are looking through that, when they start reading, they will have a much greater understanding about what they're reading about. You're giving them strategies, and this is why I talk about planning. You're giving them strategies, look, and there are lots of other pictures, B, C, D, E, and F. We can talk about those pictures. What are they feeling? What are they thinking? That means they can link the pictures, because we've given them the strategies, to what they're reading.
Simon, can you hear me? We seem to have lost your sound. Can anybody hear me? This is Peter speaking.
Hi, Peter. I can hear you, but looks like Simon's mic is on, but can't hear.
Yeah. I've lost his screen as well. Ah, no, it's back again. Yeah. Simon, can you hear us? So people can hear me, but they can't hear Simon. Hello, Simon. Simon, can you hear us? He's not even speaking, I don't think. So, Raz, is there any way you can contact him?
Just to him now.
Yes, come back, Simon. Where are you?
Is he replying?
No. No.
It's not speaking.
Hello, everyone in the audience. Apologies for this. We're trying to find out what's happened to Simon.
Looks like he is not in the meeting anymore, but I'm trying to reconnect him.
Yeah, he's left the meeting.
I think I'm back. Am I back?
I'm on your back, yeah.
I'm back. Sorry about that. That happened at my end. We had a bit of a minor disaster.
Is he back? I don't see.
I am back. Can you hear me? Can you see my screen?
Yeah, we can see your screen, Simon.
Can we see it? All right. How much did you miss?
We lost you for like more than 5 minutes.
More than five? Oh, God. Oh, okay. I'll let me see if I can.
I don't see Simon's screen yet. Is he?
You don't see my screen?
No.
Raz, can you see
here
my
it
screen?
Is. Yeah, it's back. Yeah,
I can see
it.
Back.
Okay, back. I'm back. I apologize. That was me. That was my internet dropping out. I am back. I hope everyone can see. Did I drop out? Did you hear that part, that particular slide?
Yeah, Simon, yes, you were talking about the pictures on the right-hand side.
Okay, so I was talking about the pictures on the right-hand side. Right, yeah. Sorry about that. I do apologize, everyone. I live in a small village in England, and my internet connection is not the strongest in the world. I will continue to do my best. So I was talking very briefly about how the pictures on the right-hand side can, in fact, help our students to really understand what they're reading in the text. So that when we do something like this, if we look at the pictures first, help our students to recognize what's in the pictures, can they make the links to activities in the texts? Obviously, in the book, there will be questions that link the pictures and the texts. But before we start reading it, get them to think what's happening. How many children are there? What do they think? Do the pictures follow the storyline? So that was what I needed to think about that. And what we as teachers need to do is we need to plan for this. We need to say to ourselves, what words, because we're talking about content, what words will my students need in order to be able to access that text? They might just have castle, but some of them may not. But is it a gloomy castle? Is it a forbidding castle? Is it a large castle? Is it grey and sinister? These are the content words that we will need to look at that. Look at picture E, for example. Three children holding up their swords. What's happening in the picture? What is that yellow? Is that sparks? Is it glowing? Is it energy? These are content words that we need to share with our students. So if I can move on very quickly and think about now science, it requires different content words. So in science, we need things like electricity, generate, or a generator, or an engine, or a turbine. The blades rotate. There's a difference between rotate and revolve. Wind energy, and there are so many more. We need to say, okay, do our students, if we want them to tell us what's happening in that picture, do they have the words? And this is why it's really important that when we look at this in our books, so for example, here are four little pictures, and this is all talking about the weather. What's happening in those pictures? We've got words to learn: temperature, wind, rain, weather, same, sunny, etc. But for each picture, match some words with the background, the foreground, and the subjects. So if you want to have a think about this as we're looking at that picture, which of those words could you link to the background? So for example, in picture right hand side, it must be sunny and warm because they're obviously on a beach, they're playing a bit of football. What's in the foreground? We've got some towels, a bottle of water. Those are additional words that we think about. So when we talk about this, a key for me is pre-teach your key words and phrases. It's no good just expecting that. And as a consequence, you need to plan for it. So in our books, look at the teacher resource. What words are in there? What words in the students' books will they need to understand? They may be coming across words that they don't know, so they need to think about new words for that. And what are there going to be other words in the activity book? Have a look, check them, plan it. What words will you need? And I'm absolutely insistent, and this goes against what many school principals and head teachers might think, don't help your students, challenge them. Of course you challenge them, but help them to succeed. Challenge them by giving them some more interesting words. Now, we have to scaffold it. Put them together. Don't just translate. Don't just go from one language to the other. Ask our students to think about different ways. And I'm suggesting that there are four little things that we can look at: flashcards, placemats, videos, and visuals. Scaffolding, obviously, we're building that. So for example, it took me 2 minutes, quite literally, to make those flashcards in Word on my computer. And I can reuse that once I've saved it. I can reuse those same words. And I could do that, for example, in this case, big words, which I can put up on the classroom walls, or I can print them all off together and those can go on individual tables or desks. But we can come down to an even smaller level, make the same words, just add a couple of columns, cut them up, and ask the children to draw pictures. And then we can play lots of games with these, for example. So this might be for a grade 2 lesson. So they're learning these words, let them draw the pictures so they can work in pairs. Then they cut them out, they turn all the cards over so they're all face down, and then they have to turn over two cards. If they get a match, then away we go. And you can turn it into a competition, so they're starting to learn. Placemats, if you just look for and do an internet search for placemats, subject-specific placemats, this is a weather chart. Now, what I would do with these is I would laminate that, and every child has one of those in front of them. It's a visual reference. It's a reminder for them. For older children, here is one that comes for this one, and this is a language features placemat. So for example, up in the top left, it says, remember to go through a forest when analyzing language. So alliteration, facts, opinions, rhetorical questions, emotive language, statistics, and the triple. So that's a forest. So if the children have got these in front of them as they're working, they can do a self-check. It helps them to learn and improve and develop.
Simon, sorry to interrupt. Yep, just to let you know, you've got a few minutes left, I'm afraid.
I'll cut it short and we'll move on very quickly. Okay. So videos and visuals must be appropriate for language and content. I'm going to skip these so that I'm not going to worry too much about that. I want us to very quickly look at functional language. Now, functional language joins content language. It's the links of the content language that you need, so that it's the everyday language. that we need to think about. May I go to the washroom? May I please do this? Can I do that? Good morning, hello. It links everything together. Again, help your students. Here is a SPAG placemat. SPAG, as we all know, spelling, punctuation, and grammar. It helps. Have you checked your work? Give them some additional joining language. I did have some stuff on a reading scheme, so that if at lower levels we look at this, a reading scheme supports functional language. So if we look at this series of slides, mouse jumps in the cool water, small splash. Lion jumps in the cool water, it's a bigger splash, but jumps in the cool water is your regular functional language, and it's repeated in the little books each time. Hippo jumps in the cool water. So they're helping develop the language skills. Finally, language skills. Again, it's very typical. I like to have an integrated approach, but we have speaking, listening, reading, and writing. So when we do this, work together. So what language interactions do we have in your classrooms? Most of us, and almost everything that I've seen, language interactions between teacher and student are very good. But I don't often hear student to student, or students talking to each other in a group, or students doing presentations. So think about, what do you want your students to do when you're planning? I've suggested, how would you teach this? And my way of doing it, give them some prompt cards. So get them to sit down in a group, give them some cards, and they can prompt each other. What can you see in the foreground? What do plants give off, and how do you know? So there are the words, there are the ideas. Help them develop their communication skills. And finally, on this section, think about our reading and writing. When we do our reading and writing, again, let's see how we can develop this. Give them some challenging tasks. We often talk about immersive classrooms, so they only use English, but I'm taking immersive one stage further. It's not just immersive language, it's immersive learning, where they have to give all of their attention. Language, content, physical, social, everything comes together. Give them some challenging tasks to do, such as this one, which is design a fresh water system. So we might have looked at that, and you're only given a plastic bag, a jam jar, a small bucket, an elastic band. How are you going to do that? And then we can have a look at this one. In many of our books, we have projects. So give them something to work together. So finally, very quick summary. What do you actually do in your classrooms? I want us to think and plan for these ideas where we want our students to talk to each other. Plan for it. Classrooms have a busy noise because they're discussing with each other. And if you choose the right tasks, they will stay on task. Students learn from the teacher, the textbook, and other sources. And you give them rich feedback. You're constantly supporting them, developing them, language and content together. Lessons are focused around students demonstrating what they've learned and understood. And teachers are constantly in dialogue with our students. So that is the formal part of my chat out of the way. My next slide is the feedback link. But Peter, if you want to share any questions, and before we do the feedback, if you want to share any questions, comments about this, then let's do that before we go to the feedback link.
Yeah, and Simon, please don't show your slide with the feedback link, because we realise there's a small error on it, and we're going to put up a separate one.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was brilliant. Thank you so much, Simon. Are there any specific questions that you'd like to ask Simon? Please put them in the text box. Please, no questions about certificates and getting a copy of the webinar. I'll talk about that in a minute. But any questions for Simon on the content of his wonderful webinar? Lots of thank yous, Simon. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thought-provoking. One question here. Could you just quickly re-explain immersive learning? That's a question from somebody.
Okay, very quickly. In many of our classrooms and our schools, we expect and we talk about immersion as a language learning technique where we say we only use English and our students and teachers must only use English in the classroom, for example. So that is language immersion. But I'm talking more about, and I'll go back to it if I can find the slide, where we talk about immersive learning. That means that not just language, but everything your students are doing is encouraging them to stay on task. So all of their attention is given on the task. So you've given them a goal. So they have to make something, for example, or they have to solve a problem. They have to make decisions. They have to be creative. They have to work together. It's not just language, it's all their skills. So it's immersive learning.
Okay, any other questions? Simon, can you still hear me? Because I think
my I can audio still is, hear you. Yes, yeah, I no, I can. Yeah, I'm still here. I'm just concerned that I'm not. I'm actually making.
Hi, Simon. My,
hello.
I have a question from the Q&A from one of the audience. Mm-hmm. Students sometimes have problem understanding the difference between background, foreground, subject. What can I do?
Okay. Find some very, very clear and simple pictures where the background and the foreground are very distinctive. And get them just to look at those pictures and analyze that. So the ones that I showed, the sky is clearly the background. And they just have to focus on what can they see behind the subjects, if you like. So what is behind? And if we use the words, in theory, behind and in front, generally speaking, at relatively simple pictures and photographs, the subjects are in the middle. So what's in front of the subject would be the foreground. What is behind the subject would be the background.
I suppose you could even have some labels, couldn't you, Simon, on the picture?
We could,
just to make it clear.
You know, and this is the whole thrust of it. We need, as teachers, we need to label it and say, that is the background, and this is the foreground.
Okay.
So that every visual clue comes up for them.
Okay, we've got one more question, and I know you could do a whole webinar on this, Simon, but you've only got 60 seconds.
Okay.
So the question is, what do we do about students using L1, their native tongue, when you put them into groups? You've got 60 seconds max.
Okay, what do we do when they use that? What we need to do is don't discourage it if they have to, but ask them, because we want to work in a bilingual, if they say that, then listen to them and say, can you now tell me in a different language? So don't discredit it, because lots of learning and real learning takes place in mother tongue. If we negate the mother tongue, we're not encouraging the students to actually want to use their second language. Accept and understand and idealize it, well, ideally promote L1 as well, but get them to understand that in this particular context, we want them to use L2. Make the links between them. Don't force them not to use it. Recognize the importance, but say in this context, we want to actually encourage L2. Ask them to say,
I'm going to have to stop you, Simon.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
That's actually a really lovely answer. Thank you very, very much, Simon, for joining us today. For those of you who are joining webinars next week, Simon will be back with us on Monday, the 20th of April. So not Monday next week, but Monday the week after. And he'll be joining us at 11 o'clock UK time on Monday, the 20th of April, to talk to us about lesson planning. So thank you very much, Simon.